So let us continue and finish this discussion with the servant. And the story with the servants, as you know, is that they have been part of the Ottoman Empire since the Battle of Kosovo, and that had remained a traumatic and decisive event for their common history. Most of them peasants will remain in the Ottoman Empire, governed just like we discussed before. And this is a map of how the Ottoman Empire broke down across history, you know, through history. And you see Serbia is out of autonomous around 1830, was still part of the Ottoman Empire, but then gained independence in 1878, which is, by the way, also when the Danubian principalities, United Principalities, were also definitively gained independence, although they formed in 1859. So this had been the Ottoman Empire, you see, and you have the dates, it's a very nice map. And here is when, in 1878 then, here is where Serbia will be, right? Here is where Serbia will be in 1878. But we're jumping ahead, right? They're still part of the Ottoman Empire at the beginning of the 19th century. And right? Still part of the Ottoman Empire here. This is in 1815, right? But the same process happens here as we talked about in the case of the other southern Slavs, is a process of, and the other groups discussed, is a process of discovery of, rediscovery, redefinition of nation. And that's the process they have to go through because of the modern paradigm of a state that has to be associated with a nation as such. It also happens during the breakdown and the decay of the Ottoman Empire, so there's more space for local, basically, bosses or local, you know, warlords to take over. And that's basically the beginning of, you know, Serbian statehood, the re-beginning, they would say, the restart, would be because of such uprisings against Ottoman nobles, or Muslim, you know, Muslim nobility, and Muslim rulers, Muslim nobility rather, Muslim landowners, and also through these warlords. Okay? So the first Serbian state that is established, and the first prince, the Obrenović, was a warlord who managed to kick out the other warlords and kill, eliminate his rival Serbian, you know, leader, and then he established a dynasty. So that's that's very Macbethian, the origin of the dynasty. But in terms of the good part was that around 1830, when said the Serbian land becomes quasi-autonomous within the Ottoman Empire, because it was ruled quite brutally by Serbian, meaning a Slav that was Eastern Orthodox, it also allowed for certain policies to develop and for certain things to happen, namely a sort of a cultural development that couldn't have been possible if you would have been ruled by Muslim viziers and so on, right, rulers. Namely, this pretty fierce Serbian ruler stimulated culture and kind of gave the resources, the space for some scholars to start doing what happened throughout this region, standardizing, modernizing the language. Happened even in Hungary, right? It had a long history of, you know, statehood, but actually, you know, the cultivated people spoke German or Latin, right? So it had to be standardized, updated. If this is the language of the nation, of the people, it has to be the functional language. Well, actually it was, you know, in the case of Hungarian, it was an old, not updated, they had to bring in newer language, newer words, just like in Romanian. They have to make it the functional language. It was like an older dialect, all of these languages. The functional languages were, you know, German at that point, Latin, and so on. So this was very important then, that national sort of quote-unquote awakening has to do with these few items that we mentioned before. One is language. And the famous figure who defined language in this land among Serbians was Vuk Karadžić. Vuk Karadžić is sort of a father figure for the Serbian nation in the sense of defining what Serbian, you know, language is. But because, again, it's a dialect close, you know, or identical with what is spoken by part of the inhabitants of Bosnia or in Croatia, Vukaradzic went as far as saying, okay, this is Serbian, everybody who speaks this dialect is Serbian. One of his famous writings, I don't know if I can quote the exact name, but it's something like, Serbians all and everywhere. Everybody's Serbian. Everybody's Serbian. Of course, the others will be less than happy to think that. But you see, immediately as you define nationhood, it's always an expansionistic definition. Everybody wants to be French. Everybody wants to be American. Everyone wants to be Hungarian. Even if they don't want to, they want to. Right? It's in the program. Because it's glorious to be Serbian, it's glorious to be American, it's glorious to be French, it's glorious to be Hungarian. The others were saying, not so glorious. Right? Because they're bad, they're evil. Right? It's embedded in the DNA of we need to govern ourselves, control ourselves. It's great to be Serbian. So you have the language part, right? And you see how important that it is for them to reject attempts, the Illyrian attempt from Croatia to... or the Croatian attempt to make everybody Croatian, and so on. And they will then be very careful to define it. So language, the second, Eastern Orthodox. This idea, because, you know, historically and practically, that was the set of institutions that maintained this group identity. And then folk culture. And your book talks in the pages about culture, which I specifically added today in the materials, so nation building in Central Eastern Europe materials, documents, I added, I specified where you can find words about culture during this period in all of these countries. So read those, check those out, and read those to understand these processes. And especially in the case of the Serbians, there are paragraphs, they're very good, well written. The whole book is very good, the first book, Serbian folk culture. And the fact that the Serbian folk culture was either lyrical, you know, about tragedy, passion, you know, I mean personal events, or historical, epic. And the historical epic of this folk culture, which was basically songs and poetry that was passed from father to son, not written, passed from father to son through centuries. Right? They were all about some glorious or mythical events, key to which was, for example, the Battle of Kosovo. So the Battle of Kosovo, that loss of statehood, and the image of a glorious Serbian prince, which was the Christian prince against the evil Turks, Ottomans. They are the archetypes that have circulated, never written down, kind of created the common myth, the common narrative for these people, the Serbians. And we talked about this, that Serbian identity, what we call today Serbian identity, was kept, the identity of these people, through these three things. Eastern Orthodox identity and the church structure. Folk and folk culture, basically. Folk culture that was related to certain mythical events, key to which was the Battle of Kosovo. Now, keep this in mind and you will see how important it is in 100 years later. And recently. And we're still talking about Kosovo today. Because Kosovo is at the heart of politics in Europe right now. And definitely in this area. And interesting here, though, is that there's a tension between Vukaradzic and the attempt to define, to standardize the language based on the popular language. So there's a tension between Vukaradzic and the Serbian Orthodox Church. Because the Orthodox Church didn't speak, the language of ritual was not this peasant Serbian. It was a more elevated Slavonic, which is closer to actually Russian. Not because they're Russian, but because that was the original, you know, back to Cyrillic method. That was the Slavonic basis of the church language, which, you know, write all those church documents are written in Slavonic. So when Vukaradzic develops, the Serbian language based on the peasant language, it clashes with a higher Serbian, closer to the church Slavonic that is promoted by the church. You see what interesting tensions come about. And again, remember this idea that even in Serbia as well, just like in Croatia, just like in Bosnia, they're circulated all these varieties of ideas, but the one that carried the day was the fact that Serbia is all of us who are Slavs and speak and are Orthodox, or even those who are not Orthodox but speak this dialect are Serbians of other religion. So basically, the Croatian movement here said everybody who's here is Croatian only of different religions. These ones say everybody who's here is Serbian but of different religions. So, you know, so basically Croatians too. So basically, you know, are you Catholic? You're still Serbian, says the Serbian nationalistic leader. While here, the Croat nationalistic leader said, oh, I see you're a Southern Slav who are Orthodox. That's just a Croatian who is Orthodox. So you see then how this reinforces the tendency to define yourself based on the denomination. Because the other guys try to involve you, to incorporate you in their own self-definition. Also interesting, and I'm going to conclude with this phenomenon event at this point, is in the struggle of Serbia to carve out statehood from the Ottoman Empire, they were never close to the Habsburgs. But they kind of had some strategic alliances with Russia, who is here. But again, as I said, with its growth, it always tried to push towards, well, anywhere it could. Right? Took over Poland, whatever. Part of it. And had an interest in the Balkans. And they chose the Serbians as a sort of a key strategic ally to have a foothold here. The Russian Tsar claimed to be the protector of Christians in the Ottoman Empire, just like the Habsburg, by the way. There's a clash here of interest. But the Serbians failed miserably to be a good ally to the Russians, because they kind of snubbed the Russians and also kind of are too over ambitious and fail militarily. So the Russians turn toward Bulgarians and make them the client state. Bulgarians who, you know, they were, you know, two different cultures, different entities. But in this point, it becomes, think of again the United States and its close relationship with, one of the closest relationships the United States has militarily is with what? With Japan. There's nothing common between the United States and Japan as such, right? But it is, because of history, it has become a very close alliance and a huge impact of American culture on Japan. Or same with South Korea. You know, like, so all kinds of these phenomena happen because of historical interest and spheres of interest and so on, right? Or what is the connection between Russia, Soviet Union, and Cuba? Nothing. But because of a certain ideological constellation, Cuba became a satellite state of, well, not a client state of the Soviet Union. Completely different continents. That's kind of what happens here as well. The Russians push the interest of the Bulgarians, and the Serbs are left without sponsor, without a big power to sponsor them. So by the time they have statehood, they are actually falling under the sphere of influence of Austria. Not part of it, never were part of it, but they're kind of a smaller state around this big, huge power. And a Serbian state that had ambitions of even carving out Bosnia for itself, carving out Bulgaria for itself, controlling the entire Balkans and so on. And that's an important thing to keep in mind, because World War I will start right here. World War I started in Bosnia, in Sarajevo. We'll talk about this at the end of our discussion of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which will be our next video lecture.